Thank you so much, and thank all of you for coming out tonight and giving me your attention and giving your attention to this difficult and interesting subject. I am a journalist by trade, so my engagement with Iran is not as a specialist, but really as a storyteller. And I want to tell you a little bit about how I got involved with the subject and what about it appealed to me as someone who had a desire to observe and to share the stories of the people who I met in this enigmatic country. When I first traveled to Iran in October of 2004, I knew very little about the Middle East and had never traveled there. And yet, I'd held Iran in my sights as my dream destination very nearly since I'd entered journalism. My background was in the journalism of ideas. I particularly liked to report on the place where intellectual life and politics intersected. And I was fascinated by parts of the world where the stream of ideas seemed to carry with it the current of history. In the late 90s, I worked on the Balkans and Southeastern Europe, writing about the role of nationalism in the Yugoslav wars. But even then, I was collecting a shelf of books about Iran, in the hope that one day a bigger magazine would have the will and the resources to send me there. Iran had been a no-go zone for most of my life. The 1979 revolution and the hostage crisis were among my first memories of international news events. I remember the television footage of angry crowds burning American flags. Iran seemed a forbidden place, and we Americans heard little about it in the decade that followed, when it was engulfed in a brutal war with Iraq and beset with internal political violence and repression. Even later, perhaps even now, we know Iran by not knowing it. Our non-relationship is a perverse sort of bond, by means of which many Americans have a special curiosity about or imagination for Iran, but few of us ever get to glimpse its interior. We know it as a foreign policy problem to be solved, an issue on which to take a position, but rarely as the diverse, complicated country of 80 million inhabitants that yawns between its borders. Naturally, this was a place that inspired wanderlust in an aspiring foreign correspondent with a perverse attraction to forbidden territory. But there was another reason for my attraction as well. By the time I entered journalism in the late 1990s, Iran was in the throes of a transformation, something that looked to those of us raised in the vocabulary and symbolism of the Cold War like a Tehran spring. In 1997, Iranians had elected a reformist president named Mohammad Khatami, who promised to build Iran's civil society, ease the country's restrictions on speech and association, and bring the country into dialogue with itself and with the world. We read stories suddenly about inventive, optimistic, idealistic young Iranians who surged onto the national stage with their new president, demanding democratic reform and seeking connection with a global youth culture. President Khatami had brought with him a coterie of political advisors, some of them theoreticians of the most abstract sort, others nuts and bolts political operatives. Some of them, incredibly, were the very men who had seized the American embassy and held its personnel hostage back in 1979. Others were merely sympathizers. Now they were the country's progressive force for democratic change. They took over not only the presidency, but the parliament, city hall, and to some extent the seminaries, the universities, and the media as well. They boldly reimagined their revolution as one that could incorporate liberal values and harness the energy of Iran's restive youth. This movement, I came to understand, had a significant philosophical dimension that encompassed unlikely fields of thought, like analytic philosophy and American pragmatism. To me, this was an incredible story waiting to be told. It was the story of a revolution and the state it produced, complete with its own internal forces for change. And it was the story of these men and women whose lives had passed through a crucible of history and who had come of age with the revolution they had wrought. Moreover, it was a story of ideas, ideas that had evolved down utterly unique pathways, transmitted between cultures by the idiosyncratic journeys of individual thinkers. By the time I got to Iran in 2004 and 2005, that story had already taken yet another turn. I arrived in a country far more repressive and divided than I had imagined. It was a place where ordinary people presumed their phones were tapped and that their friends and acquaintances might be informants, a world of anxiety and insecurity where the stakes of political engagement ran very high. Iran's was a society crisscrossed by class lines and cultural affinities that walled people off from one another and even when they broadly agreed on the nature of the problems the country faced, and even more so when they didn't. By 2004, the reformists' political project of incremental democratic opening had stalled, or quite possibly failed. Legions of young people born around the time of the revolution had risked their freedom and their futures to support and further the reformist agenda. They'd staffed the reformist newspapers, campaigned for reformist politicians, and answered the reformist call to set up civic organizations. By the time of the presidential election of 2005, many of those I interviewed felt disillusioned, angry, and abandoned. A good many of them had landed in prison for their pains. They revealed to me, in often shocking and unforgettable detail, the deep inner workings of tyranny, which they encountered through their dealings with Iran's corrupt and hardline penal system and its judiciary. What some of these young people saw, their elders, the politicians and theoreticians of the Islamic Republic, had grievously failed to imagine or to confront. By the time I met them, Iranians of this post-revolutionary generation were asking themselves profound questions about the future. Could such a state be reformed? And if so, how and by whom? Now I could see that the story I sought to understand unfolded in two phases. First, there was the question of the older generation of revolutionaries who'd turned reformists. Who were they? What aspect of the Iranian revolution did they represent? And what new understanding should they offer us of the revolution itself? Had they undergone a real reversal in their thinking? And if so, why? Then there was the matter of their movement's apparent failure. Was it a failure of vision or of political acumen? Had it been crushed or self-destructed? Had it collapsed of its own weight because it was a movement for compromise, playing what turned out to be a zero-sum game? Or maybe it would turn out that they hadn't failed at all. Maybe, like Ayatollah Khomeini before them, they would one day prevail through a far-sighted strategic patience whose horizon is not visible even now. The second phase of the story had to do with a younger generation born into revolution and which came of age with reform. They, too, had learned bitter lessons and evolved toward different goals. We Americans have a reputation for not thinking or caring very much about the world outside our borders. But to the extent that we do see it and wonder about it and feel connected to it, Iran looms large. At the very least, it's central among our adversaries. And a surprising number of Americans feel connected to it for reasons personal or political, dating to the Shah's time or the present. But for all that we may know about its centrifuges and clerics, or even its touristic beauties and delicate cuisine, we know perhaps less about the living souls who populate its politics and the profound inner tensions that define and rend the contemporary Iranian state. I wrote Children of Paradise because I felt that in the life stories of these two generations of Iranians, their childhood memories and political awakenings, their dreams and prison letters, a historical epic unfolded and was unfolding still. I wanted my book to be a history of ideas, of events, and of people, told with as much intimacy as I could muster, demanding that you enter the lives of these Iranian protagonists you have never heard of and try to feel what they felt, to see what they saw, to understand what they wanted and what happened when they pursued it. I believed that the story of Iran's reformists, of their origins, their beliefs, the arc of history that they both shaped and were shaped by, and of all they came to attempt, to promise, to lose, and to suffer, was a rich, dignified, and often tragic piece of living history. I had to begin with the revolution. The revolution, as revolutions do, changed everything. Maybe not the fabric of the society, maybe the same cultural and political fault line on which Iran rests now was always there, the same tectonic plates moving below the surface, throwing into relief a landscape of beauty and peril. But the revolution ushered in new arrangements between the social classes, a new intellectual environment, and a political system that was and remains unique in the world. Iran's post-revolutionary state is called an Islamic Republic, which may sound like a contradiction in terms. It's a constitution in tension with itself, with elements of representative government, including an elected president and parliament, cheek by jowl with elements of theocracy, including a cleric as supreme leader, and below him, selected bodies that have the power to veto legislation and disqualify political candidates. It is the theocratic state that controls the instruments of coercion, including the Revolutionary Guard, the judiciary, and the intelligence apparatus. The Republican state claims a limited dominion over policy and channels popular sentiment to the extent this is possible. Iran's constitution rests on two conflicting sources of legitimacy, the consent of the governed on one hand and divine right on the other. It reflects the tumult of the revolutionary period when the clerics were not the only ones vying for control of the state. The tensions at the constitution's heart have produced a kind of internal factionalization that has kept Iranian politics interesting ever since. The 1980s were spent consolidating this new state. The political battles were pitched and violent. Though the revolutionary movement had been a diverse one, by the mid-1980s, Khomeini had managed to suppress all secular forces, as well as anti-clerical Islamist forces, and to marginalize the more liberal nationalists. One thing I found in talking to Iranians was that the 1980s were a traumatic decade for a great many citizens, particularly those who were children at the time. It's not a trauma that can be discussed or shared openly in Iran today. Maybe someday, the repatriation of these memories and the mourning of the dead from this period will play a part in some larger national reconciliation. When Ayatollah Khomeini died in 1989, the three major political factions of his movement wrestled for control of the state. The losers were the faction that had once enjoyed Khomeini's favor, known as the Islamic Left. These men lost their positions in government and their purchase on the country's politics. But they were not done with their experiment in state building. During the early and mid-1990s, out of power, they convened at intellectual salons around a philosophical journal and a political think tank. Some of them went back to school for degrees in political sociology and political theory. They asked new questions about the relationship between religion and politics and about the structure of their state or any state. They read Thomas Hobbes and Hannah Arendt, Antonio Gramsci and George Lukács, Karl Popper and Max Weber. Most of all, they read an Iranian lay theologian, once close to Khomeini, and now a religious critic of the state, named Abdolkarim Sarush. It was in this time that they became reformists. We think of the Iranian Revolution as having been about the rejection of Western ideas and influences, but in truth, it was as much about their expropriation and recontextualization. Even Iran's most anti-Western theorists drew explicitly on Heidegger and eventually Foucault and Derrida to make their case against Western humanism. The history of the Enlightenment was very much with Iran's revolutionary intellectuals. They worried about transplanting wholesale schools of thought that hadn't arisen from Iranian history or culture, but they also felt that Iran could benefit from the experience of the Western world, and with forethought, could perhaps avoid some of its pitfalls. Iranian Islamism from the start drew from Marx, from Sartre, from Plato. Similarly, the reformists would draw from an idiosyncratic array of Western thinkers, ideas that served their rethinking of the theocratic state. Sarush was the seminal thinker of the reform movement, and he is in every way a surprising figure. His background was in the philosophy of science, where he became wedded to notions of scientific uncertainty. Drawing on Popper, the Anglo-analytic philosopher W.V. Quine, and the Mu'tazilite tradition of ancient Islam, he came to argue for what he called a moral secularism and a separation between faith and human knowledge. Sarush argued that religion itself was ineffable. Human discourse about religion, whether it was Islamic jurisprudence or any other branch of religious study and knowledge, was only human. As such, it was susceptible to argument, to context, and to independent rational judgment. What entered the world as nearly metaphysical observations took on in Iran political resonances. Earlier Islamists had sought to make religion fat, Sarush once remarked. He sought to make it slim. Ideology and politics were human constructs, not godly ones, in his view, and they were sacralized at religion's peril. During the 1990s, Sarush's influence grew enormously. A journal called Qiyan was founded really around Sarush as a vehicle for his thought and its discussion. It became a salon, a meeting place, and a vector that sent Sarush's ideas and their implications out into the Iranian public. For a philosophical journal, Kian had a surprisingly broad distribution, particularly among young men from traditional families, politically and intellectually engaged Iranians who wanted to reconcile their religion with their political complaints. Sarush himself came under mounting pressure during this period. He was assaulted by militiamen when he gave public lectures, denounced by leading clerics and rival thinkers close to the regime, and eventually forced to leave the country. The Kian circle consisted mainly of intellectuals, but it soon linked up with another institution that was incubating reformist ideas. This was a think tank called the Center for Strategic Research, which housed a number of prominent Islamic leftists who had flocked to the Tehran University classes of the unsuspecting secular sociologist Hossein Bashiriyeh. They became particularly interested in the role of civil society in linking the state to the masses and creating avenues for democratic participation in Iran's political life. The circle around the Center for Strategic Research also attended Kian Circle meetings and took up Sarush's ideas, though cautiously at first. These were highly religious men, some of them worried that Sarush's thinking would lead to secularism. Among them were two who would become indispensable visionaries and operatives under Khatami, Saeed Hajarian and Mostafa Tajzadeh. To read the work of these men is to see something sort of wondrous at work. They took the insights of sociology and applied them to their own circumstances, almost as though they were physics experiments they could reproduce. The watchword of the reformists was political development, by which they meant roughly the systematic construction of an independent civic space that would begin to hold the government accountable. If, for example, Iran held direct elections to local government, a provision that had laid on the books actually since the time of the Shah, but had never been enacted. So if they held these elections to local government while also allowing civic groups to organically coalesce, then the civic groups would begin to link themselves to one another and to political candidates. The local candidates would start to link themselves to the political factions in Tehran, and these would be the seeds of political parties. The rough and tumble of Iranian politics would turn out to be less tractable than these theorists imagined. In 1997, the reformists entered the political fray in earnest by running a candidate for president. Mohammad Khatami ran on the unlikely, by American standards, buzzwords of civil society and dialogue among civilizations. Khatami's campaign tapped into a deep hunger among young Iranians, particularly, for civic engagement, as well as a demographic youth bulge that was pressing for change. He brought with him to the pinnacle of Iranian politics men like Hajarian and Tajzadeh, whose plans for reforming the theocratic autocracy were nothing short of transformative. Whether he meant to or not, he also brought with him a generation of young Iranians determined to shape their country's future. When I came to the part of my book where I was to narrate the Khatami years, I imagined that the story would follow an arc of rising hopes and dawning disappointment. Like so much else, this episode surprised me. There was no preamble. Khatami was stymied nearly from the start. Within his first 2 years in office, the independent press had burgeoned and was smothered. Students rose in protest and were crushed and vilified. Secular intellectuals started disappearing and showing up dead. Khatami conducted a historic house cleaning of the intelligence ministry, only to have its most violent elements take up residence in the judiciary. Khatami held the country's first ever direct local elections, swept by reformists, whereupon their mastermind, Saeed Hajarian, was shot in the face at point-blank range on the steps of City Hall. He survived. Young people surged forth in a sacrificial wave. They took up work as journalists and civic activists, student leaders and bloggers, and many of them faced severe consequences. In the prisons, some were forced to confess to outlandish conspiracy theories involving far more powerful reformist figures who were the judiciary's real targets. These young people became the subjects of the second half of my book as I tried to understand the imprint of history on their lives and the meanings they had struggled to make of their own bitter experiences. So many of them remain optimistic that I've come to wonder whether this, along with dogged perseverance, is a national characteristic. The young people I met who took up the reformist call to action tended to come from the upwardly mobile lower middle class. They were not the elites who could afford to disappear into rich private lives or the very poor whose everyday struggles were all consuming. Hardly any had traveled abroad or could afford to study English at the expensive private institutes where it's taught. Many came from traditional families, and many carried haunting childhood memories of post-revolutionary violence or of the efforts of their parents to shield them from that outer darkness. They entered journalism or set up civic groups to help women or children or poor people or the environment or refugees, or they became student activists, not because they were fed up beyond hope, but because the reformists had opened their horizon. There was a better future within reach, and those young people hungered to help produce it. At last, they were allowed in, even encouraged. There was a use for their boundless civic energy. In the book, I follow a few of their lives closely. The stories don't end well. One after another, these young activists and writers wind up either in prison or, as I often heard in Iran, under control. The Iranian intelligence apparatus, particularly the elements of it that had taken up residence in the judiciary, was efficient and frankly brutal. It made short work of countless idealistic young Iranians. Some were beaten and tortured in the prisons or in secret detention centers. They were turned against one another and even against themselves. Their ordeals often culminated with these forced confessions, televised or printed in newspapers, in which prisoners laid out absurd conspiracies in which they claimed to have participated, together with famous politicians they'd never met. These reformist politicians did not leap to the defense of the young prisoners, who remained under pressure long after their release. One young activist told me he felt that he'd advanced with his army, only to turn around and find that the army had retreated and left him alone in no man's land. The reformist politicians had battles of their own. They'd swept the parliamentary elections in 2000, but their most ambitious legislation, which sought to expand the powers of the elected institutions at the expense of the theocratic ones, was vetoed by the theocratic Guardian Council. Already by the end of Khatami's first term, he was exhausted, announcing his run for re-election only reluctantly and through tears. The reformists lost the presidency in 2005 for several reasons. One was a reformist voter boycott that kept some liberal reformists from the polls. Another was that they ran too many candidates. Khatami's disappointing performance had fractured his movement into different camps. Three reformists, plus Rafsanjani, former President Rafsanjani, who was neither hardline nor reformist, ran in the 2005 race. Only Rafsanjani made it to the second round of voting, and he was at that time a controversial figure among reformist voters. He was an establishment figure associated with the Islamic Republic from its very inception, and people distrusted him for this reason. He was also very rich, having a family fortune in pistachios. Ahmadinejad tapped into the country's populist vein and achieved a commanding victory. I was there for that election. Some of the young Basijis, members of the sort of hardline youth militia, who I talked to at Ahmadinejad campaign stations, told me that they had voted for Khatami in the previous election. But he had not delivered any freedom that mattered to them, so now they would go with the unpretentious guy who seemed to feel their economic pain. The Ahmadinejad years were dark ones for the reformists. Young activists once imagined that they had supporters, or at the very least, eyes and ears within the system, seasoned politicians who could explain the state of play to them and would listen to their concerns. They had been told to go out and build a civil society, that this was what their president wanted. Now their protectors, as impotent as they had proven to be, were gone. By 2007, most dual nationals had been pushed to leave the country, university campuses had been gagged, and the occasional sweep landed activists in prison. And yet activism did not stop. These years belonged mainly to the women's rights and human rights activists, functioning in an almost entirely oppositional situation, in secrecy, and with increasingly high stakes. I met with some of these women on my visits to Tehran. They were among the toughest people I ever knew. So it was some surprise when the reform movement dusted itself off yet again for the 2009 election. It ran two candidates, this time, Mehdi Karibi and Mir Hossein Mousavi. Mousavi had been prime minister in the 1980s, when he led the faction known as the Islamic Left, which was pushed out of power in 1989. Although his faction was the one that became reformist, Mousavi himself had remained quiet throughout those intervening years. When he entered the presidential race, his rhetoric was reminiscent of the 80s and a little reminiscent of Ahmadinejad, in the sense that he too was a populist with revolutionary roots. But he was also fed up with Ahmadinejad's economic mismanagement, his volatile grandstanding, his disrespect for the rule of law. Mousavi's candidacy galvanized opposition to Ahmadinejad in a wave of ebullient street protests, street activism, that reminded even seasoned observers of 1979. The color of his candidacy was green, and its promise was increasingly, unmistakably, reform. Behind the person of Mousavi, reform meant rule of law, tolerance of dissent, representative politics, dignified comportment abroad, and technocratic management at home. The summer of 2009 may be one moment in Iranian politics that we all remember, whether or not we obsessively followed this fascinating faraway place before that. The regime called the election for Ahmadinejad when Tehran's polls had barely closed, and they called it a landslide. The voters in the streets were outraged. As they had understood Iranian politics for decades, turnout was the whole game. When turnout was large, as it clearly was in 2009, reformists tended to prevail. When it was small, the hardliners did. The reason for this was that the hardliners called on their followers to vote as a duty to God and country and a show of support for the regime. These voters were stalwart. They always came out, no matter who was running for what. The reformist constituency was the fickle one. It included many non-voters, people who believed that elections were window dressing for autocracy and who did not wish to lend their support. Reformist campaigns turned on convincing these reluctant voters that it was worth their while to cast a vote for what many of them might see as little more than a lesser evil. To call the election with 80% turnout for Ahmadinejad turned many of these political intuitions on their heads. If it were true, it would mean that 7 million people who had not voted in 2005 had come out to cast their votes for Ahmadinejad. But 2005 was the year when reformists had announced a boycott and hardliners had a dog in the race, Ahmadinejad himself. The disbelief was instantaneous, and the ebullient crowds turned to angry ones. For days, the streets filled with protesters holding placards that read, "Where is my vote?" The regime put these protests down with a violence the country had not seen in decades. An unmistakable message reached the reformist constituency. Khamenei and the security state he commanded were not interested in sharing power. They would rather rule by force than by compromise. Mousavi and Karabi remain under house arrest to this day. The reformist political organizations were banned and dismantled. And starting even before the vote was tallied, the security forces swept up the middle level of reformist leadership and locked it away in the prisons. Men whose names had been sullied again and again in false confessions in the Khatami period, men who had served as cabinet ministers and political advisors to the former president, now peopled the prisons and would next be seen in mass show trials. I linger on the show trials in my book because of what they reveal about the thinking of the Iranian security establishment, the judiciary, and perhaps the leader. The reformist leadership was indicted on conspiracy charges based on yet more forced confessions and manipulated narratives obtained from political prisoners. The indictments aimed not only to suggest that reform had all along been a machination of the CIA, among whose agents could be counted the philosophers Richard Rorty, Jürgen Habermas, and John Keane, they aimed to discredit its intellectual project above all. Saeed Hajjarian in particular, this was the guy who was shot in the face, was forced to renounce Weber, Talcott Parsons, and Habermas. Once, drawing on Weber, Hajjarian had classified the Islamic Republic as a patrimonial state. But in a patrimonial state, he said now in his televised confession, quote, people are treated as subjects and deprived of all citizenship rights. Of course, this was not the case in Iran, the political theorist with the bullet in his spine conceded under duress. There could be very little doubt, reading these indictments and confessions, that the Islamic Republic perceived the reformist intellectual project as an existential threat. Civil society, by definition, these indictments more than implied, was destabilizing. There could be no freedom of thought or association in Iran because these freedoms would obviously, inevitably, lead to criticism of and undermining of the theocratic system. In one of his open letters from prison, Mostafa Tajzadeh wonders at this mindset and comes to understand that he can't begin to communicate with his interrogators. His interrogators saw dissent as a conspiracy and every idea Tajzadeh held dear as a threat to be quashed. And so, he concluded, their prisons were populated with the very people Tajzadeh thought most fit to run the country. Tajzadeh is still in prison. Most of the other reformist leaders have been released but silenced. I certainly could not visit them when I was last in Iran in 2012, when the country was as tightly locked down as any correspondent had seen it. The main reformist organizations and newspapers remain muzzled. Mousavi and Karabi are still suffering under house arrest, and 2 years ago, the media ban on former President Khatami, forbidding anyone from printing his photo or so much as mentioning his name in the press, was made official. So why do we continue to hear about reform? In 2013, the pragmatic centrist Hassan Rouhani was elected president. That he was permitted to run at all was surprising, considering that former President Khatami and former President Rafsanjani, who endorsed him, were denied. Rouhani was above all associated with Rafsanjani and with diplomatic engagement over Iran's nuclear program. His background was, if anything, hostile to the reformist project. He'd taken over the Center for Strategic Research in the 90s and purged it of reformist thinkers, and he'd led the hardline counterattack on student demonstrations in 1999. But he was by far the least hardline candidate in the 2013 race. His diplomatic approach was broadly popular, and in his campaign, he professed support now for civil liberties. Reformist voters helped propel this centrist cleric from the security establishment into the presidency, where his team succeeded last year in negotiating a historic nuclear agreement with the P5+1. The reformist constituency proved essential to the president's win in 2013 and his faction's win in parliamentary elections last winter. And the reformist leadership, to the extent that it has been able to get a message out, was essential to the participation of that constituency. Does this make Rouhani a reformist? Does it at least make him accountable to the priorities of those voters? I think caution is advised. If by reform we mean the worldview painstakingly theorized and articulated in the 90s and put to the political test under Khatami, then there is nothing like reform currently on the Iranian political table. That vision was branded the sedition during Ahmadinejad's second term and placed out of legal bounds. If we simply mean the leftmost edge of the Iranian political spectrum, such a space remains, and reform-minded voters continue to protect it and to attempt to enlarge it by every means that remain to them. Last spring, reform-minded voters used a clever voting strategy to expel the hardest of hardliners from the parliament and to show that this constituency could still sway the system, even if only within its narrow limits. This came on the heels of the nuclear deal, which was a win for Rouhani against hardline foes within the system who argued that the United States could not be trusted. Having secured the agreement, Rouhani could ostensibly turn to domestic concerns. But whether for want of opportunity or of will, he still has not moved the needle much on human rights or civil liberties inside Iran. Now the Iran-U.S. relationship has taken an abrupt turn, which will undoubtedly have repercussions for Iran's internal balance of power. The hardline of the Trump administration bolsters the hardline of Iran's theocrats, who feared nothing more than a cultural opening between the two countries and are relieved that they can now double down on their anti-Americanism that had been slipping away. My best guess, however, is that they will find that this avails them less than they expected, that it was not American pressure or the American example, after all, that led Iranians to press for things like representative government and the freedoms of speech and assembly. These demands lie squarely within Iran's long history of liberation movements, of which reform is but one chapter, the revolution was another. The struggle of the Iranian resistance under the Islamic Republic is often politicized, whether here to make a case for one foreign policy approach or another, or there where it's framed as a foreign conspiracy. But the story of reform constitutes a proud, if tragic, chapter not only of Iranian, but of human history. It speaks to the most elemental politics all civilizations face, namely the contest between tyranny and the human spirit, and to the nearly inexplicable persistence of the impulse to participate in civic life, whatever its cost.
You mentioned at the beginning that some of the young people in Iran had were concerned about their neighbors informing on them and things of this nature. I was kind of curious how you gained insight into that as a journalist and as an American. If I was wondering if you might could give us a couple of examples as to how you were able to get people to open up to you, or how you made inroads into that.
For these reasons, Iran is a difficult place to work as a journalist, and particularly as a foreign journalist. On the one hand, you know, I had the sense sometimes that people trusted me because I was an outsider, so therefore it was unlikely that I was informing on them. On the other hand, people were nervous because if they knew anything about how their country manages foreigners, they might know that anyone holding an American passport is being followed and closely watched inside that country. So I always kind of had to balance these concerns when talking to Iranians and to wonder whether my presence and my questions would in some way endanger them. They also, the Iranian regime, they assign us translators who are really reporting on our movements, and you have to negotiate what it means to bring that person into other people's lives. And that was often a really difficult thing for me. I did my best to work around it, I was lucky enough to make some friends in Iran when I started out there, and to have people who would sort of work with me sub rosa and who were straight with me about what I was seeing. So I did develop some close relationships with Iranians that were incredibly helpful. And then, you know, there's the fact that while I was there, I was reporting there really between 2004 and 2012. And this was a period where, especially covering the reform movement, where a lot of these people were coming out of the country because they were being pushed out because the situation was closing down. So often there'd be people I would interview or hear about when I was inside Iran. I'd hear that they were now in exile, and I'd go find them where they were and debrief them outside the country. So you'll find in the book there are people whose stories, who are named and whose stories are told in really intimate detail. Those people are all outside the country. I could not do that for somebody who was still living there and had to worry about what might happen to people they knew. Or I mean, even the people who are outside the country, I had phone calls toward the end of the process with the book saying, oh my God, don't mention my sister's name, or this is going to have repercussions for someone connected to me inside the country. So we really had to be careful about that.
Another question?
Go back here.
If you were going to advise the present administration about their behavior towards Iran, what would you recommend based on your knowledge? And I keep hearing that they're promoting and pushing terrorism. I keep hearing that on the TV. Is that the case? Are they really that bad? Are they really pushing terrorists? Hamas, Al-Qaeda, Taliban, all this other terrorist activity? That's what you hear. Iran's the worst supporter of terrorism in the world.
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that, because this is obviously a source of a lot of confusion and dissension in this country. Iran, I think there's very little question that Iran does support Hezbollah and Hamas, and that's been the case for a long time. Al-Qaeda and the Taliban are adversaries of Iran, and so is the Islamic State. So you're looking at a panoply of groups that have different interests in the region, and Iran is the only majority Shiite country in the Middle East. Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, ISIS are virulently anti-Shiite. So these groups are not on the Iranian payroll, and Iran is actually very actively engaged in the fight against ISIS. They were on that before we knew ISIS existed. So these things are to be distinguished. Now, Hezbollah and Hamas, as I understand it, this finally has come a little bit clearer to me over time. It's a kind of a curious thing, because at the time of the revolution, the Islamic Republic made a lot of the Israel-Palestine conflict and took a very strong position, not recognizing Israel and doing whatever it could to harass Israel on its borders. This is not a hugely popular domestic position, because I think a lot of Iranians over time have come to feel like resources are being expended on a conflict that has nothing to do with them and is quite far from their border, and they would rather see those resources spent internally. But the Iranian regime has continued to invest in that, and I think the reason is strategic. as it was explained to me recently, and this does make sense, if you look at where Iran sits, and I guess sort of further to your question, I will say that I regard the Iranian regime as rational. They are, in many ways, were, before the sort of explosion of the region, a status quo power. They have interests in the region. They pursue those interests in fairly predictable ways. They're not anymore. They were at the time of the revolution, but they're not anymore a sort of rogue ideological agent that is simply seeking to sow chaos. So in terms of Hezbollah and Hamas, I think the strategic reasoning is that the Iranians sit in a kind of isolated position. They do not have a great power protector. They have a running rivalry with the Saudis and with the Pakistanis. They don't feel terribly secure where they sit, and now there is this threat of ISIS on their border. They see their interest in becoming the dominant power with regard to Iraq and Syria, which do lie on Iranian borders and which do have historic cultural religious ties to Iran. And they see their anti-Israeli involvement as a way of projecting power. So for them, they can say, you hit us, we'll hit Israel. It allows them a kind of strategic depth that they wouldn't otherwise have. So the question, is Iran the number one sponsor of terrorism? I think that's a very political formulation that serves purposes other than illumination of where this country sits in the global order and how we might make sense of its actions and of our actions with regard to Iran. The Obama administration pursued an engagement strategy with Iran, which was to say that after decades of non-engagement, the Obama administration basically came to the conclusion that the Islamic Republic is whatever we think of it. It is the government of Iran. It is a regional power. And if we are to make any sense or any peace in this region, we need to deal with them. I personally do subscribe to that view. I think that to generate a lot of conflict and hostility over Iran is going to be counterproductive and not serve American interests in the long run.
Take one more here and then I'll
come. Well, I was going to ask you, you talked about Tarush, I think it was, the reformist group. There seems to have been this conflict in Iran between the younger group of more educated people that are very interested in science, technology, democracy, all the Western values, but they're suppressed by the theocrats, by the religious element. Is there any hope that the United States can build bridges to these people? Do you think that our current policy towards them as our enemies is helping? How would you have foreign policy play out if you could build it?
Well, first of all, yes, you're right that a lot of I guess I would maybe draw the lines slightly differently, because I think that the theocratic regime, it's a complicated animal. It's not actually backward as much as it is autocratic. So the embrace of science and technology is not limited to the liberal elements of the population. Iran is a modern country, and it has been actually rapidly modernized since the revolution. When I first went there, it was one of those things that you kind of raise your eyebrows. It went against your preconceptions when you would see, clerics with their turbans and robes in internet cafes. But you do. This is not limited to one piece of the population. But yes, there has been for a long time a large population of sort of middle-class Iranians and young Iranians who want to reach out to the world, who want to forge that connection. This is seen by the regime as very threatening. I sort of mentioned this in passing in the talk, but the Obama administration, by taking this more moderate approach toward Iran, I think was seen by the centers of power, by Khamenei, as quite threatening. They fear American cultural influence, and they fear the attraction of their young people to American cultural influence, which is, by the way, profound. My feeling was that the nuclear deal would foster these connections, that the more we sort of de-escalated the tensions with Iran, not to say appeasing them, but the less that we were trying to isolate and make them into a pariah state, the more likely we could have these sort of cross-cultural connections that would be fruitful in the long run, both for Iran and for the United States. And I continue to believe that cultural exchange is really salutary. The trouble is the visa ban has now just created an entirely new and very powerful barrier to that kind of cultural exchange. And it's been received as a real slap in the face to a lot of Iranians who have relatives here or aspirations to come here. The Iran-U.S. non-relationship is just, you can't get away from it. Every time I go there, I meet people who wanted to come here. And I would ask them why, because honestly, even in the best of times for Iranian Americans, this is a complicated place to land, given the geopolitical situation. But there was a real sense that America was the place where they had the greater affinity culturally than Europe. I don't know now. I'll tell you one thing, and I don't want to ramble at too much length, but we just passed the 38th anniversary of the revolution. The anniversary of the revolution is on February 10th. So on the 38th anniversary, usually on the anniversary, there's a celebration that generally involves hardline elements in the streets burning American flags and chants of death to America. This is a very anti-American occasion, usually. This year, you would think, given recent events and the sort of ratcheting up of hostilities again and the visa ban, that this would become an occasion to rehearse those sentiments all the more so. But a very strange thing started to happen on social media. There was a campaign on Twitter where Iranians started posting, "Have you seen these pictures of all these Americans protesting the visa ban? Don't burn their flag. Respect them." And I found this actually very strange and moving, because there was a hashtag that started up called Love Beyond Flags. And there was a sort of a movement among young people to say, no, this is not the year to ratchet up that rhetoric. This is the year to show that we have solidarity at people to people, even if our governments are in an antagonistic relationship. So the day came, and this was a complicated response, because on the one hand, you had this big crowd in the streets. It was a much bigger demonstration than usual. People who were not hardliners, people from all walks of life, came to show support for a regime that many of them hated. And they did it because they felt threatened by the new rhetoric coming out of Washington. However, you had people with signs that said things like, one of the ones that amazed me was, down with U.S. regime, long live U.S. people. So this is, in a way, I guess one thing that struck me about this is that also buried in this was a wish as well, because I heard for so many years from Iranians that they wanted to be recognized apart from their government, that they felt like we in the United States identified them with Ahmadinejad, who they found terribly embarrassing, or with other figures in their establishment who they wished to distance themselves from. So I think there was, for the part of the population that was saying, we refuse to identify your flag with your president, we will identify it with you and respect it, I think that was partly something that they had wished to see happen for themselves.
Right here.
Thank you. And if I may, my wife and I went to Iran a year and a half ago with a group from World Denver, the World Affairs Council down in Denver. And you guys, we've experienced, as you have just expressed, with Iranian people, our first night there, we were there's no drinking, no alcohol, so we went to a coffee house. We have Iranian friends. We had a guitar. We started singing. A voice out of the darkness said, "Well, do you know a Beatles song?" Oh, holy smokes.
You're supposed to answer the question.
Ann, correct me just now, saying I'm supposed to be asking a question. And that's why I said I want to share with you, and it's not a question. Ann apparently didn't hear when I said, this is not a question. But I did want to share with you that the Iranian people asked for a Beatles song. We sang one. A few minutes later, they said, "Well, do you know a Bob Dylan song?" I'm like, holy smokes. And after those two songs, and somebody said, "Well, where are you guys from?" When they learned we were from America, and for the next 2 weeks, everywhere we went, when the Iranians knew that we, there were, I guess, 10 of us from Denver, World Denver, were from Americans, we were welcomed so warmly, so enthusiastically. And I've been, especially from that experience, struck by what we're all seeing and reading in our media that is so negative about Iran. And I don't understand how we, the people, as you have apparently shared with us now, Iranians also, over or under, but aside from their government, we're saying, wait a sec, there are some beautiful people there and beautiful ways for us to communicate. What's going on? Because our government, by the way, the similarities of Iran and America, the United States, are astounding in that we both have these amazing political currents, negative and positive, that disrupt the relations that our two nations have.
Well, and there's something else that I guess becomes more apparent to me nowadays. One of the themes that I really became increasingly aware of in repeated trips to Iran was how divided that society is. And it's a division that is pretty acrimonious and it runs deep. And you have, I guess, my sort of favorite anecdote about this is that when I started going to Iran when Khatami was president, reformists would say to me, 80% of the population thinks like we do. There's 20% that are committed to the hardliners, but the trouble is that they will die for their beliefs. I believed this for years, and it may be true. But when I was there, the last time I was there in 2012, which was in a moment of real hardline crackdown, and I was being managed very aggressively by the state so that I was only talking to hardliners, I had more than one hardliner say to me, and I believe they said it sincerely. They said, you know, 80% of the population thinks like we do. It's 20% who are these liberal reformists. They're just really photogenic, and people, the Western media is fixated on them. So what this said to me, this is a country where you can't take a reliable opinion poll. You can't really take the measure of public opinion by any means that would require people to say what they think into a telephone. But you can see here that these are two populations that literally don't see each other. As far as they're concerned, they don't even quite believe that the other population exists. We might see some parallels in our country, but it seemed to me that, and maybe this I also should take into some consideration, but it seemed to me that the path forward for Iran was going to have to go through some kind of reconciliation, where these populations recognized each other and found some kind of common ground.
Up to the visa ban, not considering that change in the scenery, has the nuclear deal been fully implemented? And aside from the visa ban, which is working against the implementation of what was supposed to happen, what next do you expect about the completion of the nuclear deal?
I believe that the nuclear deal is in process of being implemented, that some of the sanctions relief comes in stages. So if you're suggesting that could be stalled or reversed, that's certainly in the realm of possibility. Though my suspicion is that it won't be, and here it's uncharacteristic for me to be optimistic, but I think when I'm looking at the sort of chessboard that involves this new American administration and Iran and the region, I don't really see a way forward that that makes it really feasible to completely scrap the nuclear deal. I could be wrong about that, but for now, I'm holding out hope and have not seen much to the contrary. There is, you know, I think for the Iranians, their feeling after the nuclear deal was that they expected to see immediate and dramatic sanctions relief that would just really give a jolt to their economy and get things moving again. They've been disappointed. And you will hear people on that side claim that it's because the United States hasn't fully implemented the deal. And there's some truth to that in the sense that even though countries are now free to do business with Iran in certain areas, they have to deal with the implications if they cross. The United States has some unilateral sanctions still on Iran that come through our Treasury Department and through Congress that are not part of the deal, that were not negotiated away. So foreign countries that do business in Iran have to worry about us and have to worry about what it means for them to do business there and maintain ties through American banks and so forth. So that has been a great frustration to the Iranians, particularly to Rouhani's faction, which really needs to show something for having negotiated. That said, Iran also has really profound economic problems that are not going to be solved by the removal of sanctions. And some of these are becoming more apparent all the time, and they are going to have to deal with the fact that once they don't have sanctions to blame for some of those problems, there are going to be some domestic political chickens that come home to roost.
Thank you, Laura, very much.